Hello and welcome back to Innovation Oxford. I'm your host, Mike Harding. We're here at Megan Thomas's farm north of Drumbo to take a look at how she is farming and has a particular point of view. Right now, we're going to meet the cows. Megan, tell us a little bit about what makes this breed of cows special.
So these are Canadian Lynch Linebacks. They're a heritage breed. They're what the English settlers would have brought over with them when they settled around the Kingston area. And so they're a dual purpose breed. They're bred for meat and milk, and they're a smaller cow, so they're good for a small family farm.
And this is, how much your acreage here, 30?
I have 30 acres of pasture, 58 acres altogether.
And so that's perfect for these animals.
Yes.
Now, you don't breed them for their good looks. I mean, obviously you're breeding them for a purpose. Describe for me why people should consider buying their meat.
Tastes better. I raise them on grass, and they're efficient grazers because they've never been bred for having food put in front of them in a barn like a lot of the other breeds have. So they will convert grass to meat and milk very efficiently, and I think it tastes better, and it's better for your health when the cow's eating its natural diet.
And so where can they get this meat?
I sell by halves or quarters. You can put a deposit down in the spring and then your meat's ready in the fall, or I'm at the Woodstock Farmers Market on Saturdays.
And do people understand what it is you're trying to do here? I mean, you have a particular point of view about what you call real food. I mean, how would you describe your point of view in terms of this or other products you're actually growing here?
I would describe it as real food, not like packaged processed food. And then the fact that all of my animals are raised in their natural environments, eating what they're supposed to eat. And I think research now is showing us that the fat profiles and things like that are actually better for our health once we start eating like our ancestors did.
So, I mean, you have more than this here, don't you? I mean, what other kinds of animals are you raising?
I do. I have cows, sheep, pigs, and chickens.
And do you have like a lot of people working here?
No, it's me and my dad.
Just you and your dad?
Yeah.
And you didn't start in thinking about running a farm, did you? I mean, did you grow up on a farm?
No. Well, my parents were hobby farmers. So we had 4 acres and always a few chickens and sheep when I was growing up. But no, I went to school to be a librarian. And then I think learning about research and access to information and learning when I wanted to know about what to eat for my own health, and all I learned about how farming practices can impact the quality of the food and the environment is kind of what led me down this path.
Mm-hmm. Tell me why 2 of your cows are white.
There's 3 of them.
3?
And they're also from Robert Lynch, but they're Randall Linebacks. Randall Linebacks. So the Randall family was across the river from Robert Lynch, and they kept that kind of color of cow going, and they kept a dairy farm there. So the Randalls are more of a dairy cow, and then Robert Lynch had kept a few of them as well.
By cross the river, you mean in the United States?
Yes.
Okay, all right. So these are American cows.
Their ancestors were.
American ancestors,
yeah,
you know.
But he talks about how they used to swim cows across the river.
Really?
Yeah, when he was a kid.
That's amazing. I'm glad to hear that somebody's looking after our American cows. Tell us about the pigs that you're raising. You have a unique point of view about those as well.
Okay, so I have Tamworth pigs and
Tamworth.
And English large blacks. They're both heritage breeds from English side, and they have a darker meat and a more marbled meat than commercial pork would. And that's because commercial pork was marketed as the other white meat, and so therefore they bred their pigs to be more lean. The English and heritage breeds, their genetics weren't tampered with. So they're the, like, I get a lot of people at market that say, oh, it's going to taste like pork used to when they were kids. And it does.
Really? Is that what it amounts to?
Yeah. It's a darker meat, more marbling, not dry like lots of people think pork is. Yeah, and delicious.
And of course, you wouldn't be selling anything that wasn't delicious.
No.
I mean, what do people think about you at the farmer's market, you know, when they realize that you haven't been raised on a farm family and you know, that you've got a relatively small parcel of land here? What do you think? How do they treat you?
I think a lot of people think I'm doing a good thing.
Yeah, and you have a point of view.
Yeah.
And so they're buying into your philosophy, wouldn't you say that?
Yes, and I think a lot more research that comes out now is supporting it, like grass-fed beef. Like 10 years ago, you couldn't find grass-fed beef anywhere. That's why I started raising my own cows. I had to rent land from a family friend, and I kept a few cows there.
Really? And is that your hobby? I mean, that was it. Your backyard had cows in it?
I only had 4 acres at my parents' house, so I had 2 pigs and 30 chickens, and then I rented land for beef, and I just buy yearling calves in the spring and raise them for the fall. But yeah, because I didn't have access to this kind of meat, and I wanted good quality grass-fed beef.
Now, you didn't grow up reading Charlotte's Web, did you? I mean,
Of course I did.
Did you get fond of the animals you were raising? Where you knew where they were going?
Yes and no, because I get that question a lot. I have my breeding stock, and they all have names, and they have personalities, and I adore them. And then there's also this bull calves that are born and piglets. Like, I know right away that they're going to the butcher, so I try not to get attached. And I think a lot of people are not recognizing the respect we need to give the animal for providing mm-hmm. their life for us. Mm-hmm. So that's why I make sure these animals get the best life they possibly can. And then the day they go to the butcher is their only bad day.
So that's an interesting way of putting it, but you're really not into factory farming, are you?
No.
Yeah. And so, I mean, you pay more? Does it cost? It must cost more to deliver that meat. Do you charge your customers more?
I have to.
Yeah.
It costs more. I say factory and commercial farming is trying to do everything as cheap as possible, and I'm not cutting any corners. I think a lot of people raise heritage pigs and they still feed them crap, but my pigs get an organic, non-GMO grain, and they're outside on pasture. And even the butcher costs a premium to have a heritage breed butchered because of their darker hair. So it is more expensive, but I think it's worth it. Especially this type of farming, more and more women are doing it.
Well, the sense that I have too is they're coming back to the farm. In other words, the kids, certainly 20 years ago, they were really concerned that the kids were not coming back to the farm. And then they sort of smartened up a little while ago and said, boy, there's a real job here, and mm-hmm. we can make some money doing this. Mm-hmm. And so this allows you, a sense, to have a point of view for your products that's going to differentiate yours from Schneider's or Maple Leaf or something like that. But it's not going to replace all of them anyway.
Yeah. I think, too, it's definitely the right time. The consumer is asking for better quality meat, and they want to know things were raised ethically. And because they're willing to pay what it costs, that's why I'm able to farm the way I am.
So the future looks good for you.
It does.
Yeah, it does favor you, doesn't it? I mean, to have a distinct point of view. I mean, it's. I think that's the next generation of people, particularly the millennials, are buying into what you're selling and paying the price.
Yeah.
So your chickens are running around in the forest. Why is that?
Well, they can go anywhere they want. They are my egg layers, and they are free range chickens.
And what makes their eggs so special?
Well, they're outside, so they get to eat grass, insects, and lots of different things. So then you'll get a really orange looking yolk that's firmer. It'll be thicker looking, and it tastes way better.
And the albumin sits, is that what it's called? The white stuff? It sits up higher?
Yeah, that's thicker. That's what
thicker. And so what makes them so highly prized? You know, why should I care? They're eggs.
Well, if you read the science part of it, apparently it's better for you.
Hey girl, how are you? How are you? Gonna blow that in my nose? Yeah, I agree. So this is the dark breed, right?
Yeah,
this is the black, and she will give birth to black piglets.
Yes, because my boar is also a large black.
Right.
But
and this is the kind of pork that our ancestors would have eaten here.
Yeah.
You know, Lord Simcoe and would have eaten this kind of pig, Laura Secord would as well.
Yes. Well, and even my grandparents remember pork that tasted like these pigs taste.
Well, you know, you're making us hungry. We're just going to have to come to the Woodstock farmer's market and buy some to actually check it out. But you've got other kinds of pigs and little piglets that have a different color.
Yes.
Maybe we can take a look at those.
Sure.
Although she seems quite friendly. Aren't you? These huts behind us, we can see that they're planted on the ground. What's in them?
That is pastured chicken.
Why do you need, you have free range.
Yes.
And they obviously know where they want to go eat. There's something different about these.
So these are a breed for meat, and they don't like to walk around as much as the free range do. So I move them twice a day, so they always have fresh grass.
So this looks like a roof. You simply put in a new spot, and then they go eat there.
Yeah, so it's floorless, so they're on the grass, and then the chicken net wire over top keeps them protected from things like skunks and raccoons and hawks. And so they're safe in there, and they're getting the benefits of natural sunlight and fresh grass.
And still called free range?
Pastured.
Pastured. Pastured.
Pastured
and
chicken.
That produces a different, no, that's for meat, right? Not for eggs.
Not for eggs. Eggs are free range.
Okay, all right. And so, I mean, there's a lot going on in this farm. It's like deceptive. And it's all to do with your particular point of view, isn't it?
Yeah.
And so you're developing customers? I mean, do you have lots of repeat customers?
I do. Actually, once people taste free-range eggs, they're sold.
They're never going back?
Yeah. And pastured chicken, it definitely has a different flavor. Heritage pork, different flavor. I do it. All of my sales up until this point have been word-of-mouth sales.
So that's the future for small farms, sustainable farms here in Oxford County. Have a point of view and live it off. For Innovation Oxford, I'm Mike Harding, and I'm definitely going to be trying some of your eggs and your pork and your chicken. Thanks, Megan.
Thank you.
Don't be eating like a pig, okay? Come on, take it, chew it all up, come on. Oh, look at that. Frighten them away when you give them a lesson in etiquette.